Thanks for joining us for Celebration of Worship. First United Methodist Church is a welcoming community of faith that strives to be a place where everyone can belong, believe, and become a blessing. At First United Methodist Church, you can come just as you are to grow in your desire to know Christ, as well as discover your own unique way of making the world a better place at 201 Monroe Street in Jefferson City. We hope you enjoy today's message.
Well, good morning to all. I want to welcome each of you to the service today, as well as a greeting to all of those who are watching us via the TV monitor at home or the computer monitor through the live stream, as well as our recorded TV service. So welcome to all of you to First United Methodist Church. My name is Steve Buchholz. I'm a retired UCC pastor, but very graciously accepted the invitation to be your congregational care pastor way back in July of last year. So I'm enjoying my few hours a week that I spend with you dear folks, mainly working making calls in the hospitals, nursing homes, and for homebound people. So really enjoying that. And Daniel is enjoying a well-deserved break this weekend. He is with his family. It was spring break for public schools here in Jeff City. So we wish Daniel and his family all the very best, as you kind of got the B team in here today. So anyway, let us hear the word of the Lord as found in John's Gospel today. I'm going to read a portion of this long lectionary reading, as was said earlier, that this is about the woman at the well. We've had water, rain that we needed so badly, so we're going to hear a little bit more about this. This particular passage from John, by the way, is really loaded with a lot of nuances and deep meaning. So hopefully in our time of reflection, we can maybe lift up a little of that. But first, let us hear the word as recorded by John. So he came to a city of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and so Jesus, wearied as he was with his journey, sat down beside the well. It was about the sixth hour of the day. There came a woman of Samaria to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." And Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself and his sons and his cattle?" And Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give them will never thirst. For the water that I shall give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." And the woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water, that I may not thirst, nor come here to draw." And just then the disciples came, and they marveled that he was talking with a woman. But none said, "What do you wish? Or why are you talking with her?" So the woman left her water jar and went away into the city and said to the people of the city, "Come, see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ?" And they went out of the city and were coming to him. Many Samaritans from that city believed in him because of the woman's testimony, "He told me all that I ever did." So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. And they said to the woman, "It is no longer because of your words that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Savior of the world." And may God add his blessing to this hearing and reading of his holy word. Thanks be to God. Amen. Well, let us bow for just a brief word of prayer. Holy God, giver of the word through your Son Jesus, as well as all those you inspired in the Hebrew scriptures to record your being and your ways and will, we ask you now to draw near to us as we reflect upon this word, and as you place your thoughts in the mind and your words on the tongue of this mortal pastor. For this we ask, O Lord, in the name of your Son, the one who gives living water, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Well, friends, as I was contemplating this scripture passage for this Lenten season, by the way, this is a great Lenten gospel as we're finding Jesus journeying ever so closer now to his final destination of Jerusalem and Calvary's Hill. Jesus had been on one of these journeys, and he's wearied, as John records, and he goes to the well. And as I was thinking of the well, I couldn't escape thinking of my childhood. How many of you often take a trip down memory lane and recall things of your childhood? Sometimes they just pop in your mind and something will trigger it and you'll say, aha, yeah, I remember that. Well, I remember visiting as a child my great aunt and uncle in Holstein, Missouri, in dear old Warren County. That's where the area where my mom grew up, and we would often go visit about once a month or so to visit all of mom's relatives in Marthasville and Holstein and Treloar and all those places. So I went to visit my dear great aunt and uncle Otto, Edna and Otto Bruggenjahan. Yeah, Otto and Edna, they were the typical little German couple, you know, and they had this cute little home, and I recall that there was this nice screened-in porch with a concrete floor, and on that porch was an old cistern, and gosh, that cistern was a real intriguing thing for my sister and me and for our cousins who were kids who lived in this little village of Holstein, and they were thrilled to see my sister and me come because there weren't many kids to play with. So we shared, of course, Edna and Otto as our great aunt and uncle. So they would come up there and we'd visit, and we were intrigued by that old cistern, and that cistern had on it a wonderful little dipper that hung on the cistern with an old rusty crooked wire. And so, as devilish little kids would do, we would crank and crank and crank, and all of a sudden, we'd hold that dipper under there, and there'd be a gush of water come out. And wow, that was a real thrill, because then we had kind of done something a little wicked. And we would then pass the dipper around, just as if we were sharing communion. And it was really, really kind of fun. It was a novelty. It was a novelty. Now, if we know that in that day and age, even way back then, because I'm getting up there years on the odometer, but we did have running water in our home, and Edna and Otto did too, so we didn't have to worry about that. But this well, this cistern, was a novelty for us. Now, if it had meant work, I doubt if we would have seen it quite as enchanting and quite as novel. Well, we find the story today of the woman who came there every day to Jacob's well. And she didn't find that it was a thing to play with, or nor was it a novelty, nor was it enchanting. It meant hard work. Walking a long distance every day to gather water for her family, for washing clothes, for cooking, for cleaning, for watering her livestock, She had a real heavy load job. She found nothing novel about that, but she did discover one novelty at the well. There was a man standing there, and she took him to be a Jew, and he took her to be a Samaritan, and she was a woman, and he was a male. And back in those times, there was no socialization between Jews and Samaritans. They really had a rift going between them. And it dated back centuries, because the Jews felt that the center of worship was at the temple in Jerusalem, and the Samaritans felt the center of worship was at the top of Mount Gerizim, or Gerizim, however you want to pronounce it. So this cultural rift, religious rift, had been brooding for centuries. And so there was no friendly thoughts about that between the two of them, at least on her part. But you see, one of those layers I was talking about as I introduced the scripture today, one of those layers is the fact that Jesus was there to break down some barriers, to give us something interesting to think about. He said, you know, I came not to destroy the law and the prophets, all those old prejudices and all those old held beliefs and hatreds. I came not to destroy your religion or my religion as a Jew, but to fulfill it. So this was something that was, he came to a very ordinary place to talk to this lady, and she said, why are you talking to me? Jews don't talk to Samaritans. And there was another thing that he was broadening an understanding, breaking down some old barriers, was the fact that he initiated conversation with a woman. And he is a Jewish rabbi, teacher. They weren't supposed to do that. Jesus was looking at a broader, bigger picture of things. He was time. It was time. It's time, kind of like our issue for the school board. It's time. And it was time to look at things in a new way. Okay, so he meets her in an ordinary setting. And how often do we miss the Christ? How often do we miss the opportunity to receive living water in those ordinary places of life that we find ourselves in? It's another layer to this scripture. And we sometimes think the only place that we can find Jesus is in a highly supercharged emotional setting. And we figure, well, then he will pop out in front of us just like a jack-in-the-box. Boom, boom, here I am. But let me tell you, in my own personal experiences, maybe yours too, maybe you have found Jesus more vividly offering you that living water in the ordinary places when something is heavy on your mind. Maybe sorrow, maybe fear of something that you fear with your own health. Maybe when you get those years on the odometer, you begin to think about your own mortality. What's it going to be? So you're there at the kitchen sink. I help Becky with the dishes a lot. And I'm with my little brush that's got soap in it. And I'm cleaning. And then a thought will come to mind. And I have to feel that it's Jesus offering me not tap water, but living water, helping me deal with some of the things on my heart and my mind. Sometimes I felt sorry and sorrow for a church member who was undergoing some really tough things. And I will admit it, there's times that I would literally be going along my day and I would weep just because I was so moved and sorry and sorrowful for people. And I'd be at a stop sign waiting for the traffic to move, and all of a sudden a gush of, I guess, living water. And I felt peace. I felt renewed. I felt safe and felt okay for that person. Maybe walking from the car to your office or to your place of work, you got this burden that you're dealing with, and it's sorrowful, and I don't know if I can face another day at work, and all of a sudden, you find that living water. For me, anyway, those are the places that I find Christ probably more vividly even than in those highly supercharged emotional settings. Although I love great music concerts, and I love great worship with great music. That's wonderful too. But all I'm saying is, don't dismiss where Christ offers you living water in those ordinary places. You know, so often we can be in the midst of something really meaningful and great and miss it. That woman at the well, she almost missed who the Messiah is. She almost is settled for water. She could have settled for the Messiah. Well, I remember, you know, a time a few years back, an example of this. We can miss greatness when it's right in front of us. A pastor friend of mine in St. Louis was attending a baptismal dinner, you know, often after a baptism in church. I know First Church has one at 11:15 today. Oft times, not always, but oft times, families would invite the pastor over for and his wife for a meal with the aunts and uncles and grandma and grandpa and all those dear folk as they celebrated this precious little one's baptism. And so my friend was telling me that he was, it was a late spring day, they were out on the deck, the men were, the women were inside, they were doing, you know, they're talking and doing all their things, cooing the baby and all of those things, and the men were out there just jawboning about whatever, and so the young man said, "Pastor, come out here, I want you to meet some of my family and some of my friends." And so, you know, the pastor, like we do, polite talk and shake it. "Oh, how you doing?" "Yeah, just like me, I forget names sometimes." And he didn't know all those names, he said. But anyway, "Oh, gosh, it's great, great day." So Pastor Buddy told me this in great detail. He said, "Then I turned around, left, and got ready to go home. And then I got done. We had to be somewhere later," he said. "So I couldn't go back to the deck again. But," he said, "it hit me. Twist. Right over my head." He said, "I'm not much of a sports fan, but the pastor, my buddy, said, I think I remember now, one of those people on the deck, they said his name was Kurt Warner." Twist, went right over my head. And he said, "I got to thinking, gosh, that guy was an MVP for the St. Louis Rams. And they took him to the Super Bowl. I missed a big opportunity here. It just went right over my head. It could have been so much more. I could have talked to a real NFL star." How often do we miss those wonderful opportunities? Maybe we're not tuned in. Maybe we're just think, "Well, I don't think Christ can really come to me. I'm just a sinner in the need of grace." Wow. Well, you know, that's where we miss the mark. I love Daniel's theme this year during Lent. You know, he's got that arrow, and sin is where we miss the mark. That's a place where we miss the mark. And maybe the sin in that is that we don't believe in ourselves enough. We want to believe, but yet we don't believe. "Lord, I believe, but help my disbelief." You know, be open to those times. Those wonderful times that Christ is offering you living water in ordinary, everyday places, because that's where the Christ is, as well as in worship, of course. Well, there's another thing here that we need to consider in this wonderful passage, and that is Jesus came to this woman, and all of a sudden there were things very subtly beginning to explode right there in that encounter of conversation. And she wasn't getting it all at first. He was talking in metaphor, poetic language about living water, and like her and my friend and many of us, it goes right over our head. She was thinking, when he talked about living water, that she would maybe no longer be burdened about coming to the well anymore, and that would ease her load, of course. And then he began to unfold all kinds of things about her life that she thought, started scratching her head. "I think this guy must be a prophet. Maybe more. Who knows?" Well, she got so excited. She got so excited because no longer was she thinking about the differences in their theological differences of where proper worship, the center of worship, should be in Mount Gerizim or Jerusalem, because Jesus now was expanding. her thoughts a little bit, maybe beyond, maybe there's something more important than what we think, where the proper place of worship is. Maybe there's something more. There was grace being offered there. You see, grace is part of the molecular structure of living water. Ever thought about that? That just popped into my head. I don't know. I never thought of that before. But see how God uses us like a funnel sometimes. It really is. She began to almost feel like a little bit of relief. She got so excited that she left her water jar at the well to go into the city and tell the people, the townsfolk, about this guy. Now, this is something pretty significant. She left her water jar at the well. She came there thirsty and left with an appetite for something more. No longer could her old thoughts about and worry and hostility toward where the proper place of worship is to be, that jar no longer could contain those feelings of prejudice and hatred and all of those feelings. How about us? Where do we need to leave our old jars of prejudice and beliefs and things that we maybe had learned many years ago that are so sacred to us that we just know it's right and we can't let go of that? Or maybe our attitude about ourselves. Maybe we have, at times we all do, we're only human, we suffer with maybe lack of self-confidence or low self-esteem at times. And the world will indeed knock you down, I'll tell you, many times. And sometimes when the world hits you in the knees and you go flying to the floor, you do have to leave some of those old feelings, because now a new understanding of life has come unto your heart. And that maybe wasn't so important anymore because of what Mrs. So-and-so said about me. That's not so important anymore. I've got bigger things to deal with. So I have to leave. Maybe I'm being invited here by Jesus to leave those old feelings about Mrs. So-and-so. That's not that important. That's a low priority anymore. I used to make it too big of a priority. I didn't like the way she gossiped. But I'm going to leave that at the well now because I've got other things to deal with. I don't like the way my relatives treat me sometimes. I feel neglected. Sometimes I think my grandkids like my wife, their grandma, better than me. Well, I got to leave that at the well, because I know that's not really true, but sometimes we get our feelings hurt. There are so many things in our lives that we need to change. This gospel reading with Jesus broadening the horizons of this Samaritan woman, this gospel reading among many things, okay, now the arrow's going to maybe hit the mark, is about change. It's about change. We many times no longer, those old jars will no longer do. Those old attitudes that we harbor in our hearts and have been festering for years no longer will do. It's like old worn out clothes that don't fit you anymore. They served their day, but now they no longer fit. We have to change. Jesus is about change. We hate it. Many of us do. Crotchety old German that I am, I don't always like change. And that's why I have to keep sipping deeply on the water that Jesus offers, that living water, so that I will be hydrated in a wonderful new way of understanding life and God and Jesus and the faith and my whole role in it. I need to sip deeply from that living water and leave those old jars behind, leave those old clothes behind. It won't do anymore. They just won't do. So there's a lot of layers to this particular reading. We have national prejudices too against certain people. It's not the Christian way. Jesus wouldn't want it that way. Sometimes we have to be the aggressor, not with guns, but with love. Yeah, we got to protect ourselves. But have you ever thought of the power of love? It's what raised Jesus from death. It's why he offers us this living water. to get attitude adjustments, to get new clothes. It's fun to go shopping for new clothes. Have you ever thought of that? It's fun to go shopping for. Maybe it's fun to get a new attitude about something or about someone. That's fun. That can be fun. It can be refreshing, like living water. Well, I think you guys get the point. I don't know whatever happened to Aunt Edna and Uncle Otto's old home in Holstein. They've been gone for 35 years. They lived well up into their 80s and early 90s. Loved that dear old couple. Uncle Otto was already gone when I was ordained, but Aunt Edna did get to come to my ordination 43 years ago. And I still think of them, dear people, and I think of that old cistern. And I wonder what happened to that little dipper. You know, it may have gone the way of all old things that no longer are appropriate or interesting to us anymore, or even will hold water for us anymore. Maybe it was thrown away. Maybe it was sold at an auction. But what I do know is there are things that Jesus wants to give us through his living water, and that is a whole new outlook on life. Wants to give us abundant life. Think about that, abundant life through this water that quenches deeper than anything on earth can do. May you be open. May you hunger and thirst for this living water. Thanks be to God. Amen.